the mystery of shadow and light. The atmosphere completely and profoundly captured in his images. The smoothness of his lines, the sensitivity and the spiritualism, the exquisite shading. These are the unmistakable characteristics of the style of Leonardo da Vinci. Raphael learned from Masaccio equilibrium, from Leonardo the purity of drawing and the secrets of shading, from Fra Bartolomeo solidity, but in his own genius is fashioned the ideal of the Renaissance, the serene harmony of form. Michelangelo brings to painting the essence of statuary art. The strong gesture, pathetic. A sculptor above all, he gives us solid objects, works born of his ideas of enormous scale. These are the key points of the painting of the 16th century, of a Renaissance which was born in Italy in the 14th century, and which spread throughout the rest of Europe during the following 200 years. The historian Jakob Buckhart defined this time as the birth of humanity and modern conscience after a long period of decadence. Despite the fact that during the first third of the 16th century, Spanish painting assimilated Italian methods and models, its taste for the anecdotal style was still placed in the realistic Hispano-Flamenco tradition. From then on, due to the influence of the court and the elitist demands of the humanists, Spanish painters began to get closer to the influence of Raphael and to Italian mannerism. However, the drive toward classicism did not succeed in displacing all of the emotional alternatives, which, like the painting of the Divine Morales or of El Greco, encouraged popular piety. The religious and devotional character of the paintings of these years restricted irreverent themes, which were relegated in most of Spain to palace circles or to the regal collections of the nobility. However, it was in southeastern Spain where the 15th century Italian Renaissance first penetrated. At the head of the new style was the figure of Rodrigo de Ossona the Elder, creator of Calvary in 1476, which can be found in the church of San Nicolas in Valencia, and in which the influence of 15th century Renaissance from the school of Padua merges with the Flemish style. Very similar to the aforementioned altarpiece, we have in the Church of Santa Maria of Alicante the panel of St. John the Baptist and St. John the Evangelist. MUBAG keeps a priceless painting by Rodrigo de Ossona, The Crucifixion. His son, Ossona the Younger, followed the style of his father and devoted himself to the nature of architecture, creating effects in perspective, typical of the legacy of 15th century Renaissance, as seen in the series of Saint Dionysius in the Cathedral of Valencia. A contemporary of Ossona the Elder is the Italian Pablo de San Leocadio, who, in 1472, worked on the Cathedral of Valencia under the commission of Alexander VI. Probably his earliest work is The Sacred Conversation, housed in the National Gallery in London. But where one can best recognize his style is in the altarpiece of Gandia, where his own temperament and the flavor of late 15th century Italian Renaissance coincide. Most representative of this are St. Michael and Weeping Before the Dead Christ. Although its attribution is under discussion, the Virgin of the Night of Montesa is also believed to be his work, a beautiful panel that breaks with the tradition of Valencian virgins of the 15th century. The scene is pure Renaissance. Whilst the Renaissance style of Ossona and Pablo de San Leocadio ruled in Valencia, from 1506 two Spanish painters emerged, Fernando Yáñez and Fernando Llanos, disciples of a new stylistic tendency, that of Leonardo da Vinci. They assumed a new way of conceiving space and composition through clarity, grandeur, and spiritual repose in the scenes. In the altarpiece of the cathedral, they created a composition different from the Gothic tradition. They had learned from Leonardo to look for realism through an intimate complicity with the spectator using the sfumato technique. Works slightly unfinished with strokes of uncertainty. The image now is, in essence, subject to the general laws of nature. Until the second third of the century, the style of Raphael only manifested itself sporadically. It prevailed fully, above all, in the Valencian school, thanks to Vicente Matip and his son Juan de Juanes. Matip, a prestigious maestro who probably trained in Italy, undertook the altarpiece of the Cathedral of Segorbe. He carried out an imaginative synthesis between what he had learned from the work of his predecessors, Yáñez and Llanos, and the new developments brought from Italy by Raphael and Sebastiano del Piombo. In his Raphaelesque style, one can appreciate the grandeur and the technical sobriety which will disappear in the work of Juanes. In The Baptism of the Savior in the Cathedral of Valencia, the devoted attitude of the artist, far away from Italian interpretation, makes clear the characteristics that set apart Spanish Raphaelism. Probably by his hand in the Prado Museum are the tondos, or circular paintings, of the Martyrdom of St. Agnes. A composition inspired by The Amazement by Raphael, as well as The Visitation, in which the background landscape, small, precise, and rich in detail, reveals a Nordic pre-Raphaelite steadiness that is not seen in Juan de Juanes. Matip learned from humanism a sense of serene beauty, balanced, so that it not only reflects a different way of living with religious emotion, but also gives visual coherence to a more uniform and domesticated courtly society. Compared to the clarity of the works of the father, those of Juan de Juanes are more mellow, their intonations more varied, and their tones smoother and undefined. Juan de Juanes is the creator of various types of iconography that attained wide popularity. Unlike the other Raphaelites, his paintings are rich in images of the Virgin and the Child and the Holy Family, where the known Renaissance and the revitalization of religious sentiment are combined. The theme of the Virgin and the Child is at the center of his The Marriage of the Venerable Agnesio, the most beautiful sacred conversation from our Renaissance painter. Juan de Juanes drew inspiration from an engraving by Kerber, and he paints the Virgin with clasped hands, a white robe and a blue cloak. Thanks to the simplicity of the figure, the smoothness of the yellow, the pink and the radiant blue, and the clouds, the conception gives the appearance of ecstasy and mystical contemplation. In this work, Juanes comes closer to Fra Angelico. Another of his great paintings is The Last Supper. Influenced by Leonardo, it is inspired by an engraving by Marco Antonio Raimondi, imitator in his turn of Raphael. Around the theme of The Last Supper, we also have his revered paintings of The Holy Eucharist in half body. Amongst his histories of the saints, the best known is the series of St. Stephen, which is housed in the Prado Museum, in which he shows his skill in creating compositions with numerous characters. Amongst Alicante artists of the 16th century, Friar Nicolas Borras stands out most. Born in Conventina in 1530, he was one of the most exceptional disciples of Juan de Juanes. He created an altarpiece for the monastery of San Jerónimo de Gandia, for which his fee was entry into the order. After a brief time with the Barefooted Order of San Francisco in the convent of San Juan de la Rivera in Valencia, he returned to the convent in Gandia, where he produced many works. The works of Nicolas Borras can be found throughout the whole of the province of Alicante. Outstanding amongst them are the altarpiece of the parish of the Savior in Conventina, his restored panel in Banieres de Mariola, and the altarpiece of the parish in Ibi. In Alicante, in the Cathedral of San Nicolas, can be found his Altarpiece of the Souls. MUBAG houses two oil paintings on wood by Nicolas Borras, works small in dimension, which probably formed part of an altarpiece which is not conserved in its entirety. These panels, St. Vincent the Martyr and St. Lawrence the Martyr, were probably part of the predella or base of the altar. Born in 1571, Cristóbal Llorens was an outstanding Renaissance painter. Although a follower of the pictorial tendencies of Juan de Juanes, his work is full of his own characteristics. Amongst his best paintings, the History of St. Dominic, which is kept in the Museum of Fine Arts in Valencia, stands out. MUBAG houses a beautiful work by Cristóbal Llorens, St. John and St. Joseph with the Child, painted with oil and egg on a pine panel. as well as paintings, sumptuous decorative art, sculpture, and small religious objects, MUBAG houses some priceless hymn books from the 15th century. Some bargueños, typical Spanish chests, some exquisite Spanish furniture, typology of the 16th and 17th centuries in the Moorish, Renaissance, and Italian styles. Some vestry doors with iconography of two archangels also from the 16th and 17th centuries. And a beautiful carving of the Virgin from the 17th century. As much for the quantity of artists, as well as for their originality, one could consider the 17th century as the golden century of Spanish painting. The artists dedicated themselves to naturalism as a response to the Baroque period. The models were drawn from the lowest social levels, and the fashion to paint characters, sometimes unusual characters, is a true testament of this. The thirst for reality, characteristic of the Spanish temperament, moved them away from the heroic interpretation of religious themes offered by Italian and Flemish Baroque, bearers of a certain theatrical falsity. Our religious Baroque painting distinguished itself with a particular style, charged with emotion. Perhaps the best example can be found in the mystical paintings of Zurbarán. In this naturalistic style, Spanish sobriety abounds in comparison to the Italian movement. In moving away from Raphael, Spanish painters rediscovered their own sensitivity. The compositions are simpler, and the characters in the paintings reflect ordinary life. But this naturalism did not succeed in extending the pictorial genres as transpired with Dutch Baroque painting. Spanish painting is, in essence, religious and to a lesser degree, portraiture, although the quality of Velázquez more than compensates for the shortage of specialized painters. As for the rest of the genres, only in still life does a different style appear. There were many painters of flowers, some landscape artists, or painters of battles and even of architecture. But these are isolated figures that did not succeed in creating a school. Two genres, however, do deserve separate mention: the aforementioned genre of landscapes and that of the pagan myth. From the purely technical point of view, the early date by which our painters became involved in the study of light is outstanding. Fundamentally, thanks to Velázquez, our Baroque painting reached a height still unsurpassed in the representation of likeness. In Valencia, religious iconography became established thanks to the work of Juanes. Whilst international art gave up the search for a realistic view of the world. In general, art returned to piety, propaganda, and to education. Its goal still not necessarily based on pleasure or beauty. Artistic practice intellectualized at a time when the control of the ecclesiastical hierarchy became stronger. All of this made it necessary for the artists to change. Many of them disappeared, incapable of adapting to the new artistic directives. Juan Ribera, Archbishop of Valencia, played a big part in this conflict. His presence in Valencia marginalized many artists, amongst them Juan de Juanes. The theologists of Trento thought that the aesthetics of mannerism and its intellectual background failed to represent the new Catholic proposals. As an alternative, simple art was required, realistic and everyday. In order to carry out these propositions, Archbishop Ribera relied on Juan de Sariñena, famous in the city for the realism he had brought to the altarpieces of the Palau de la Generalitat. He commissioned him to create a series of devout characters, executed with criteria far from the traditions established by the Mathip family. The altarpiece of Luis Beltran merges a simple and straightforward composition of Renaissance origin with a new approach to the figure of the saint, drawn in rough outline over a dark background. The serene image of religion that Juan de Juanes offered changes to the representation of earthly life as a new form of death. Another of the big supporters of Archbishop Ribera was Francisco Ribalta, a painter at the head of the new Baroque movement and an anti-reformist. Ribalta was educated in the Escorial, where possibly his interest for chiaroscuro was awakened, and he became one of our first tenebrists. His work, Preparations for the Crucifixion, shows, in spite of its mannerism, an interest in light unprecedented in our painting, other than that of Navarrete. This same courtly training can be found in the altarpiece of Alchemisi of 1603, in The Beheading of St. James, inspired by the canvas from the Escorial by Navarrete, although the Tenebrist effect is more intense. In the same altarpiece is pictured St. James in the Battle of Clavijo, riding triumphantly and indifferently over a confused mass of Muslims. Ribalta, influenced by the arguments of Archbishop Ribera, who led the idea of expelling the Moors, could not have expressed with more precision the triumph of Christianity over Islam. The Prado Museum has two important works by Ribalta: The Apparition of the Archangel and the Lamb to St. Francis is perhaps his most beautiful study of light, whilst The Crucified Embracing St. Bernard, apart from being an excellent example of his Tenebrist style, proves that Ribalta is not only a technician of light, but that he also knows how to interpret the finest forms of ecstasy. In St. Francis Embracing the Crucified, housed in the Museum of Valencia, the mystical rapture of the saint and the serenity of Jesus are most impressive. In the same museum, one can admire St. Peter with intense chiaroscuro. And The Last Supper, in which Ribalta arranges the figures around an oval table in order to center the composition around the Eucharist, one of the most important points of controversy for the reformists. It is interesting to compare this Last Supper with that of Juan de Juanes in order to show the long journey undertaken by Valencian painting. MUBAG houses a priceless oil on wood attributed to the school of Francisco Ribalta, the head of St. Peter. This well-preserved painting, with a varnish perhaps too brilliant, shows the aged face of St. Peter, with a large beard and eyes in a trance, gazing towards heaven. Although he was born in Játiva in 1591 and began his apprenticeship with Ribalta, which puts him in the Valencian school, Ribera developed and flowered in Italy. His true masters were the greatest of Italian painters. Known in Italy as the Little Spaniard, Ribera is one of the most important exponents of Tenebrism. He left for Italy, influenced by the ideas of light advocated by Ribalta, in order to study the works of Caravaggio, who died a short time before his arrival. But his lights and shades differed from those of the Italian painter. His heightened sense of tenebrism brought him to darken his works more intensely. He saw in light a dramatic value and the element that lent mass to form. Ribera is one of the pillars of naturalistic Baroque. He tackles reality with eyes wide open, as in the realistic literature of the time. Club-footed boy in the Louvre Museum is absolutely realistic, and The Bearded Woman from 1631 is so palpably truthful that it can cause disgust. The search for reality manifested itself in the pleasure with which he interpreted the aging of human skin, the faces and hands, full of wrinkles, even bleeding flesh. In Ribera, religious themes dominate. In The Birth, housed by the Louvre, his ability to interpret the quality of objects is a wonder. And in The Wedding of St. Catherine, exhibited in the Museum of New York, composed in a style still Renaissance, the female models again bring us close to this great painter of reality. But Ribera is, above all, a painter of saints, and in particular of penitent saints and martyrs from the early days of Christianity. Of his paintings of martyrdom, that of St. Bartholomew from the Prado Museum stands out. His sense of grandiosity, learned from Roman sculpture, is tangible in his saints in full body repose. Outstanding at the Prado Museum are Jacob's Dream, The Liberation of St. Peter, and The Penitent Magdalene. Jerónimo Jacinto de Espinosa is a noteworthy painter from Alicante, born in Conventina in 1600. Initially trained by his father, by 1616 he was already enrolled at the recently created College of Valencian Painters. His first known work, The Redemption of Christ, still evokes the world of the Ribaltas. Between 1640 and 1646, he must have travelled to court and to Sevilla, where he would meet Velázquez and, importantly, Zurbarán, an artist who would profoundly influence his work from then on. The last 10 years of his life were the most fertile, carrying out important commissions for churches and convents in the region. Some of these works are conserved in the Museum of Fine Arts in Valencia. His work, influenced at the beginning by Ribalta, evolved into an extreme and very expressive realism, allied to the compositions of Zurbarán. With a rich palette where shades, reddish and earthy, predominate, reminiscent of the Bolognian school. His masterpiece is The Last Communion of Magdalene, dated 1665. MUBAG keeps an important oil on canvas by Jerónimo Jacinto de Espinosa entitled St. Peter the Martyr. Apart from paintings, MUBAG looks after two priceless carvings, one of St. Nicholas and another of St. Joseph. Thank you. Upon his ascension to the Spanish throne, Felipe V, grandson of the Sun King, found himself ruler of a kingdom in absolute decline. Accustomed to the luxuries of the French court and with his knowledge of the arts, Felipe V wanted a royal chamber with artists capable of carrying out his commissions. His first wife, Maria Luisa Gabriela de Saboya, wrote to the Madame Royale, "If we had good painters in Spain, you would already have got our portraits. But those that they have done are so bad that I have not chosen one. When we have more settled times, we will send for a French painter." Saboya would never see this, but the second wife of the king, the cultured Isabel de Farnesio, would. A group of foreign artists would come to invade the court. With the short reign of Fernando VI, the lights began to shine in Spain. His Portuguese wife, Barbara de Braganza, took charge of the great work of the Monastery of the Visitation in Madrid, known as Salesas Reales. Fernando VI continued with work on the Royal Palace and created the Royal Academy of San Fernando, sending Spanish painters to study in Rome and bringing to our court painters such as Jacopo Amigoni and Corrado Giaquinto. The figure of Carlos III brought a fertile period. His support for art turned the court in Madrid into the artistic capital of Europe, bringing together the three greatest painters of the time, Giaquinto, Tiepolo, and Mengs. Madrid acquired prestige throughout Europe with constructions like the Aduana, the Palace of Buena Vista, the Gate of Alcalá, and the Prado Museum. In Alicante, the Maritime Consulate was established, in whose bosom was founded a flourishing school of drawing. The century ended with the reign of Carlos IV, perhaps the monarch who was most fond of painting. From a young age, he began to assemble a splendid collection in the Casita del Príncipe in the Escorial. The royal chamber now boasted a list of mainly Spanish artists. In 1799, Francisco de Goya and Mariano Salvador Maella are named as the first painters of the chamber. Carlos IV will support the creation of a national museum, an idea that his son Fernando VII would realize. The Valencian tradition, the only school that at no time showed alarming signs of decadence, had established since the previous century public schools of drawing. In the middle of the century of light, the brothers Ignacio and José Vergara established a studio of drawing in their workshop that enjoyed great popularity and the protection of the establishment. The academy relied on the favor of Fernando VII and of his wife, Barbara de Braganza, to whom it dedicated its name. The death of its protectors accelerated the demise of the academy. Its members looked toward Carlos III with the aim of forming the new Academy of San Carlos. The works produced by the Academy place it in the first line together with the Academy of San Fernando in Madrid. In 1778, it created a studio of flowers, most important for the business of Valencian silks. The success of this studio moved Carlos III to establish the so-called Cabinet of Flowers and Applied Decoration. Even though Valencian art declines noticeably, and the names of Ribalta, Ribera, and Jerónimo Jacinto de Espinosa, stars of the previous century, still overshadow the emerging artists, the painters of the Circle of San Carlos lack neither quality nor interest. José Vergara was born in Valencia in 1726. From a long artistic line, he is the prophet of academicism in the city of his birth. In 1752, he founds the Academy of Santa Barbara, presenting the painting Mentor Advising Telemaco of the Dangers of the Island of Calypso. And in 1768, he establishes the Academy of San Carlos, of which he was Director General. Together with the precision of drawing and his restraint in using colors in his self-portrait, we have a series of religious pictures with a profound Italian flavor. In these works, human emotions are left aside by a unique artistic instinct, as in The Adoration of the Kings and Rest on the Flight into Egypt. In order fully to understand this painter, one must visit the parochial church of Chiva, a veritable museum of Vergara. In the Provincial Museum of Fine Arts in Valencia, one can see the amazing Cain and Abel. Born in 1772 and a disciple of Maella, Vicente López won at the age of 18 San Fernando's first prize for painting. Carlos IV named him Painter of the Chamber, as did Fernando VII, who brought him to the court. He was Director of Painting and Director General of the Academy of San Fernando. He painted with oil, with tempera, and in fresco, a technique he used with great ability to adorn the vaults of the royal offices and the dressing rooms of the king. His works can be seen in the Prado Museum and in the Royal Academy of San Fernando, among others. Among his works, MUBAG keeps one of the official portraits of Fernando VII, a painting that belongs to the Maritime Consulate. A lover of every detail and an excellent draftsman and rich colorist, he created large compositions of a religious or historical character, as well as numerous portraits of personalities of the time, and smaller pictures for different parish churches in Valencia and in the rest of Spain. With regard to painters from Alicante, Vicente Rodes Ares stands out. He was born in 1791 and educated at the School of Drawing of the Royal Consulate of Sea and Land in Alicante. He studied at the Academy of San Carlos and achieved great fame in Valencia for his miniature portraits in pastel. He made his home in Barcelona, where he was named Professor of Color and Composition in the School of Fine Arts after painting Abraham taking to wife his servant Agar. Although he worked in other genres, Rodes was a great portrait artist with a careful technique and a grasp of psychology. All of this within the demands of pure academicism. MUBAG houses a portrait in oil by Rodes and a series of portraits in pastel. José Aparicio Inglada was born in Alicante in 1770. He trained in Valencia and went on to the Royal Academy of San Fernando in Madrid, where he won the first class prize with the canvas Godoy Presenting the Peace to Carlos IV, for which he received a grant in Paris. A successful student at San Fernando, he achieved great popularity at court for his painting The Hunger of Madrid. Although he painted in the religious genre, he also painted works inspired by classic antiquity. Without doubt, Socrates teaching a young poet is outstanding. His portraits are also very interesting. For example, Queen Etruria and her children. All of his compositions show a very constructive and linear technique. MUBAG keeps two of his works, Judith and Portrait of a Lady. José Antón was born in Alicante around 1770. It appears that he studied as a disciple of Agustín Espinosa, who enjoyed the title of painter of the city of Alicante. In 1807, Carlos IV named him the king's painter. During his time in Madrid, he painted coats of arms and carriage and coach decorations for the royal service of the queen. MUBAG houses two works by José Antón, The Virgin Carmen and The Holy Virgin. Between the 18th and 19th centuries, José Peyret Alcañiz is born in Alicante in 1775. In Valencia, he was a student of Vicente López Portaña, although he was also to study in Alicante at the School of the Consulate, where he left some works looked after today by MUBAG. allegory of geography, and the muse Urania. At the end of the 18th century, the figure of Vicente Suarez Ordóñez was intimately involved with the Maritime and Land Consulate and its school of drawing. He became known as the Italian painter, perhaps because he'd been in Rome. He drew well with charcoal, with sanguine and ink. And he liked classical models, horse portraits, landscapes, and detail in the quality of the robes and attire. This is shown in the allegories of Asia, Africa, and America, which can be seen in MUBAG. As well as a splendid view of the city of Alicante. Paintings inherited from the circle of the consulate and which form part of the art collection of the Provincial Council of Alicante. Apart from statuary art, sumptuous decorative art and furniture, MUBAG keeps several pieces of 18th century Valencian Baroque furniture. A bed and two chairs, as well as two articles of clothing, a frock coat and a gentleman's waistcoat. Worthy of separate mention is the work of the sculptor Francisco Salcillo Alcázar, born in Murcia in 1707. A prestigious artist, he produced excellent carvings. At his hands was created one of the most precious jewels housed by MUBAG, the St. John of God. The contrast between the poverty of sculpture and the riches of Spanish painting of the 19th century can only be explained by the figure of Goya, who is credited with the union of the past with the future. Breaking with the guilds, the painters were able to access two types of client: those who commissioned portraits and those who looked for paintings in order to decorate their homes. Now it wasn't just the royal family and aristocrats who had their pictures painted. The nouveau riche ordered enormous portraits, and the unsophisticated bourgeoisie contented themselves with more modest pictures. Thus, a procession of faces and costumes helps us to get to know a century through its portraits. Our 19th century began with the War of Independence, and the painters of the Goya school moved away from the ruling classes, becoming closer to the lower orders, who had defended their independence, who went to bullfights and to pilgrimages, or who conspired against the politicians of the time. Their paintings portrayed this society without gloss, anonymous people but humanly interesting, reflecting their ideas and customs in pictures of profound purpose. Historical paintings, only a dozen of which remain that are capable of honouring the 19th century, together with the surge towards naturalism during the third quarter of the century, and landscapes inclined toward this naturalistic tendency, set the scene for this century. Without doubt, the most important feature of MUBAG is the painting of the 19th century. On display in many of its rooms is a large collection of canvases, the majority of which are by painters from Alicante with national and international reputations. To these, one can add well-known names of the Romantic period, almost all of whom are Andalusian. The portrait of Don Tomás Roberto of Spain is by the hand of Antonio María Esquivel, one of the most interesting personalities of Sevillian Romanticism. Dated 1856, this portrait is crafted with solid skill and fluent design. With a severe and at the same time serene face, it tries to show the personality of the sitter. The strong pose emphasizes his elevated social position. Saint Catherine, dated 1849, is without doubt one of the most noteworthy works by Agustín Gómez Villa, a painter from Cadiz and disciple of Murillo. The gentleness of the saint's face, with the typical palm leaf of martyrdom, does not contradict the sensuality that it exudes. Agustín Gómez applies to this canvas a diaphanous technique and warm coloring. MUBAG exhibits a reduced painting of a mass by José Rodin, a Sevillian romantic whose work was tinged with a strong everyday flavor. The original is housed in the Prado. This version, entitled The Prayer, whose creation one can fix in 1860, lacks the left-hand side, in which the priest celebrates mass accompanied by an altar boy. A feeling of tenderness and sincere piety is obvious in the work, in which the ideals of brotherhood that the characters radiate are not out of place. The Comuneros of Castilla, painted in 1860, is also a reduced version and one of the most celebrated works of the Alcoyan Antonio Gisbert. It is housed in the Congress of Deputies in Madrid and won the first prize in the National Exposition of 1860. In this work, Gisbert, animated by his liberal ideology, offers us his vision of drama and his mastery of drawing and color. Gallant Scene, a work he must have painted in Paris, owes something to the language of Rococo. The success of this type of canvas can be explained by the agreeable theme, the brilliance of color, and the care taken in the reproduction of the clothes. These same qualities are present in many of his portraits. An excellent example is Blue Lady, whose elegant look does not disguise a good-natured and modest appearance, tinged with a hint of melancholy. The cleric reading a book, painted around 1870, Halfway between genre painting and the portrait is by another Alcoyan, Ricardo Navarrete y Foss, a painter who spent much of his time in Rome and in Venice. This canvas is outstanding for its detailed work with light and shade, and above all, for its prodigious ability to capture the human form. The Lover and Woman in the Church are two of the three works kept by MUBAG by Plácido Frances, another of the painters born in Alcoy, and who at the age of only 23 created one of his best compositions, St. Francis and Brother Leon. A canvas impregnated with an academic air. Drawn with great care and definition, the realism of the face of St. Francis is outstanding. In the picture, grey tones predominate, which, due to the smoothness of the chiaroscuro, help to define the mass of the figures. Francisco Laporta, a magnificent draftsman and profound colorist, came from the same center of Alcoy and devoted himself to representing spiritual values. He finds in religious themes his source of inspiration, reflecting his Catholic faith. The Alchemist is one of his works kept by MUBAG. The somewhat sweet painting of Mystic Rose, surrounded by an aura of light, overflows with a feeling of purity and fervor. Historical in subject, although with social connotations, is St. Ferdinand and the Poor, a work by Francisco Jover Casanova, an artist born in Muro del Coy. The scene reproduces the interior of an ample room and a big table at which are seated a large group of the poor. The monarch pays them careful attention. This focuses the spectator's eye towards the loudness of his cloak, which contrasts with the white of the tablecloth. Born in Orihuela, Joaquín Agrassot is one of the most enthusiastic representatives of the aesthetic realism of Fortuny. Agrassot, one of the best painters from Alicante, practiced all of the genres. Portraiture, religious painting, landscape, and the painting of customs and manners. MUBAG exhibits View of the Port of Alicante, a work dated 1875. A valuable graphic document that allows us to get to know an area so deeply linked to the history of the city. The brushstrokes show the ease of movement in his work Manola. Odalisk is another of his magnificent canvases, full of spirit and orientalism. The undoubted quality of the Alcoyan Lorenzo Casanova can be seen in those of his works that are kept by MUBAG. In Prayer to Dawn, the innocence that the painting radiates is moving. On a dark background, the figure of a child at prayer is silhouetted. Her whiteness is a song of purity and innocence. Also dedicated to the infant theme is Children's Game. The modest dimensions of this picture do nothing to reduce the freshness nor the vigor of the scene. He uses a more chiaroscuro technique in Cervantes' Dream, in which we find a sense of realism that relates to Spanish tradition. The scene invites us to enjoy the details offered by the table covered with objects, one of the most successful parts of the canvas. Landscapes are represented in the museum by one of the best pieces by the Alicante painter Francisco Buchel y Lausat. His Sunset in Florence, dated 1864, is a magnificent example of the art of landscape painting in the Romantic style. Buchel adopts a point of view that puts him in the center of the River Arno. Without doubt, the twilight sky that dominates the canvas is most impressive. In the work of Antonio Amarós Botella, a painter born in Alicante, one perceives a common touch that reveals his admiration for the humble man. Without compromising his beliefs, Amarós does not dwell on painful subjects. Thus, in Children Dancing, a quiet color transmits the difficulty of the lives of the people who, in spite of everything, are happy. He returns to the realistic cause in Laundry Woman of Scarpa, painted in Rome in 1880. This work, in spite of the landscape, turns out to be a touch hard and the brushstroke somewhat heavy. A realism tinged with social content is depicted in the painting The Bankruptcy, a work by the Alicante artist Pedro Serrano Bossio. Fruit Seller, painted in 1889, was sent from Rome to the Provincial Council of Alicante in order to show Bossio's progress as a grant recipient. In 1894, it was featured in some expositions organized in Alicante by the Society of Friends of the Country. The figure of Emilio Sala, a painter from Alcoy, allows us to see the best and most advanced Spanish painting of the second half of the 19th century. He especially favored portraits that lent an elegant and cosmopolitan air. Portrait of a Lady, housed by MUBAG, is created with fluent brushstrokes that give it a touch of modernity. The museum has two of his excellent paintings, Allegory of Letters and Allegory of Music. The world of allegories dazzles with this light and vaporous style in which the female figures dominate the picture with their colorful presence. In another excellent painting, The Hashish Smoker, he shows us his passion for the Oriental. The composition centers exclusively on a solitary, lifeless body, a Moor, lying beside a hashish pipe. Fernando Cabrera was born in Alcoy, a city in which he lived all of his life and where he left a considerable group of followers. In his work, it is possible to recognize a period under the influence of the Roman school and another inclined toward Valencian customs and manners and the landscape. The three of his works housed by MUBAG belong to this second period. In Do You Need a Model?, prize winner of the national competition in 1901 and bronze medal winner in the Salon de Paris in 1902, the color and the light become leading characters. The work breathes happiness and vivacity, which can be attributed to the rapid brushwork. Flower Seller, dated from 1920, is a good example of Valencian customs and manners. But without doubt, one of the greatest works of his life is Portrait of Sorolla and His Wife. This magnificent example alone is enough to recognize the genius of Cabrera and his outstanding role in the history of Spanish portraiture. Eliodoro Guillén is the author of Alone, dated 1899. A disconsolate woman shows her desperation upon the death of her son, leaning on the catafalque on which he had been laid. The scene is heartbreaking. The atmosphere of tragedy is intensified by the contrast between the lighter foreground and the darker background, where the dejected father mourns the loss of the boy. In the canons of strict realism, The Riveter is a complete compendium of the tastes and limitations of Lorenzo Pericas Ferrer, an Alcoyan painter with a strictly local resonance. In this scene, some children watch an elderly man repairing some earthenware pots. An identical impression of stillness is produced in the painting Rehearsing a Mass, in which we see some children gathered around a priest who plays the harmonium. Although not valued sufficiently, Vicente Poveda y Juan, a painter born in Petrer, was an excellent landscape artist with a purified technique and brave brushwork. This is demonstrated in the small canvas Landscape of a Terrace in Rome. This work, clearly painted in the Eternal City in 1890, shows a spontaneity in the treatment of the scene which brings him close to universal impressionism. The pair of canvases Old Peasant Man and Old Peasant Woman by Rafael Hernandez López, a painter born in Alicante, count amongst his best works. In a dignified way, the artist shows his attraction for common souls who lived in rural surroundings. In these canvases, the ability to observe daily existence and the great naturalism that brings both figures to life is outstanding. We close the brilliant journey through the 19th century offered to us by MUBAG with the canvas Joseph Imprisoned, a work that was featured in the exposition held in Alicante in 1894 by Mariano Anton Serra, an artist trained in the Madrilenian school. The biblical scene develops into an interior of a fortified enclosure and is achieved with the aid of careful drawing, to which is added a colouring of profound chiaroscuro, with the lightest area surrounding the figure of Joseph. Despite the changes in international culture at the beginning of the 20th century, official Spanish culture continued to favor unchanging classical models. With a few exceptions, our painting failed to shine as it did in France, where Monet, Cézanne, Lautrec, Gauguin, and Matisse made up the new artistic vanguard. Some painters like Juan de Echavarria, Iturrino, Zuloaga, Vázquez Díaz, Rossignol, Casas, and Picasso went to Paris in order to find the freedom of the artistic revolution. Official Spain will be slow to recognize the fundamental contribution of these great artists. In the Valencian region, painting followed regional or local models. Pinazo Martinez successfully exhibited in New York and Havana, and Joaquín Sorolla shone with particular brilliance, radiating with his vivid personality a powerful energy through color. In Alicante, cultural activity was slower. Predominant is a romantic academicism inherited from Lorenzo Casanova, who had created an academy around his ideas. An outstanding group of painters trained in his studio. Upon Casanova's death, his favorite pupil, Adelardo Paridia, took charge of the Academy of Fine Arts in Alicante. The work of Paridia pays special attention to landscapes, which provide the setting for his figures, and one can appreciate his interest in light. Of the abundant output of this exquisite still-life painter and painter of portraits and landscapes, MUBAG houses four works: Fisherwoman, Shepherdess, and two still life with fruit, created with very rich and colorful strokes. Andrés Buffon also began his training in Casanova's studio. Son of a shipwright, this excellent painter had the sea at the center of his works. On the walls of our museum are exhibited two of his canvases: Searchlights on the Sea and Portent of a Storm, painted in 1931. The artists of Alicante came together in organizations such as the Circle of Fine Arts, the Society of Writers and Artists, the Cultural Association of Benalua, or the Center for Science and Literature, which played a big part in the culture of Alicante from 1923. Emilio Varela, also educated in Casanova's academy, and perhaps the most important artist in Alicante during the first half of the 20th century, was a member of this circle. MUBAG boasts numerous works by this audacious, original, and prolific artist. Casino of Alicante, Street and Roofs, Borough of Santa Cruz, Landscape, Mediterranean Landscape, The Pergola, Self-Portrait, Country House, cubist still life. Monterrat landscape. Portrait of Isolde Espla and son. Guarda l'Est with little figures. Several works by Gaston Castelló, also a member of the Centre for Science and Literature and an excellent painter and muralist, can be seen in MUBAG. The watercolour, Convicts Taking a Nap. Calpe. View of Villa Joyosa. The Castle of Santa Barbara. One of the best interpretations ever of the large area occupied by the castle and an important part of the city. And Mother and Son, a scene which, despite a certain element of human drama, has a gentle effect. In close-up, a mother, alone in the absence of her husband, holds her son upon her knees. The grandfather, painted with exquisite care, looks at his family with resignation. Manuel González Santana, another member of this circle, was one of the most outstanding figures of Alicante Impressionism. Two works by this self-educated artist of international acclaim are exhibited in the museum. In Landscape and Landscape of Amarador, we notice the tiny brushstrokes with very luminous colours that change the surface of the canvas into a background of speckles, through which the artist exteriorizes the energy of his pictorial style. In 1921, the Circle of Fine Arts in Alicante celebrated the regional exposition of painting and sculpture. Outstanding artists at the time took part, such as Lorenzo Aguirre, an excellent portrait painter and painter of large compositions. Of his works, our museum houses Portrait of a Woman, in which the central character is a female figure sitting on a chair. The facial expression is an invitation to the spiritual universe of the woman. The sobriety of content does not exclude a strong juxtaposition of light and shade that helps to focus attention on the face and hands of the woman. During this period, the works of Rigoberto Soler Pérez stand out, the last great painter from Alcoy, born in the 19th century. MUBAG exhibits four canvases by this great landscape painter and exponent of local impressionism with a great lyrical feeling. The Water Cellar. Ibethan Cove. The Patio. And Market Scene, one of his most succulent compositions, which was exhibited at the National Exposition of Fine Arts in Barcelona in 1944, and for which he won second prize. The Center for Science, Literature and Art was re-inaugurated in 1923. In the February of the following year, it exhibited the works of the sculptor from O'Neill, Pasquale Sempere. MUBAG keeps one of his works, Farm Labourer, a wooden sculpture that won the first prize in the Provincial Exposition in 1955. In this center, there were some outstanding expositions, such as that presented in 1925 by the painter Francisco Rodriguez Clement from Elche, known on occasions as Little Sorolla. The museum has two examples of his work that capture the best of his painting technique: Landscape with Figures and Allegory, a work with many ancient and contemporary references. Painted in 1932, it pays homage to the nude body of a woman. He chooses an atmosphere of chiaroscuro, with the main light concentrating on a figure in a trance. In 1935, exhibiting his first individual work at the center was the excellent painter José Pérez Gil. His compositions include portraits, still life, and above all, landscapes of a dazzling quality. Our museum looks after a good collection of canvases by this artist. Pools of the Salinas, Reeds of the Salinas, gold medal winner of the great national prize José Antonio Primo de Rivera, Almond Trees of Ifac, and Almond Trees of Santa Faf, a canvas in which, like many others, Pérez Gil shows us his fondness for his beloved places in Alicante. In somber, post-Civil War Alicante, the 1942 exposition, organized by the Commission of the Fiestas of Alfonso El Sabio, stands out. Important Alicante artists of the time exhibited there, such as Manuel Baeza Gómez, an artist who won countless prizes at expositions and biennial shows. Three valuable canvases by his hand can be seen at MUBAG: Boats, Little Girl with Windmill, and Bird Seller, which, it is estimated, was painted between 1952 and 1954. The composition, which is embedded with a figurative approach that he would always follow, received the first prize from the Institute of Fine Arts at the national competition held in Alicante in 1958. The sculptor, Adrián Carrillo, also exhibited at this exposition. However, we have to come to the 70s in order to appreciate the change of figurative language towards a more modern standpoint. The museum looks after two of his works: Nude Female and Without Title, sculptures of lyrical form that put new energy into space. During the 1940s, the work undertaken by the Provincial Council of Alicante in organizing provincial expositions of fine arts was outstanding. At the first, in 1944, the top prize went to José Mateix Monyor, disciple of Cabrera Cantó, from whom he inherited a passion for landscapes, developing a brilliant and colorful style. MUBAG keeps two of his works: Peaceful Illusion and Landscape, the most exquisite canvas of all his output. This is a work in which Mateix seems to feel more at home contemplating the landscape from an elevated point. With this original and privileged setting, the earth restricts the space occupied by the sky. Another of the participants of this exposition was Xavier Soler, a student of Adelardo Parrilla, whose art was expressed by quick brushstrokes and a supreme beauty of color. Four canvases by this artist of magic realism are included in the collection of the museum. Covered armchairs, inside of a bedroom with figure, hat shop, and old women conversing, winner of a national prize presented by the Provincial Council of Alicante in 1954. The images invoked by this painting become symbols of a potent creative force, originated and nourished by an unrestrained vitality. In the second Provincial Exposition of Fine Arts held in 1946, the artist Francisco Pérez Pizarro, self-taught and one of the personalities most representative of the Spanish vanguard, took part. Starting from a style more or less classical, Pérez Pizarro moved towards an abstract style, both lyrical and musical at the same time. Of his work, we can sample a series of untitled watercolors and a work from 1952 entitled Spring on the Reservoir. The picture shows us, with dark tinges and with a strong and impressive impact, a desolate vision of external reality that perhaps had something to do with the state of mind of its creator. From the end of the 1940s, numerous expositions of the artists of the time were held in the casinos of Alicante and of Elche. During the decade of the 1950s, the casino in Elche presented various expositions by young local artists, like that of the interesting artist Sixto Marco in 1955. MUBAG keeps two of his canvases. Worthy of mention is the contribution of the Savings Bank of Southeastern Spain, which from 1952 mounted numerous painting exhibitions. In 1959, Julio Quesada, one of the best of Spanish watercolor artists, exhibited there. MUBAG looks after an interesting collection of watercolors by this extremely prestigious artist. Salamancan chap. Grain market. Minorcan Cove. City of Ghent, which shows us a monumental vision of one of the most beautiful cities in Belgium. The images lead the eye towards the background, wrapping us in a damp atmosphere. And Port of Ciudadela, in which we don't know what to admire most, the speed of stroke or the beautiful picture of the port. During the second half of the 1950s, intense debates took place with contributions from the likes of Equipo 57, El Paso, or the Valencian Grupo Papayo, which attempted to harmonize with international artistic tendencies. These were the times in which Eusebio Sempere presented his new realities, his first shining mobile reliefs. By the universal painter from O'Neill, investigator of problems posed by light, color levels, mass, the combination of geometric forms and lyricism, one can see four works in our museum. Rhombus and ovals, virtual rotating movement. Evolution and overture of the circle. And without title, in which the interweaving of lines gives us a feeling of mass and spatial depth, resulting in a severity that does not contradict the more delicate lyricism. In the context of Alicante, official art of the 50s was promoted through the competitions of the provincial headquarters of the Union of Education and Leisure. Like, for example, the grand national prize of the painter José Antonio Primo de Rivera. Vicente Pastor Calpena, considered to be one of the best contemporary naturalists, won the first provincial prize in 1957. Five of his watercolors are housed by MUBAG. Bodegones Street, Toledo. Still Life with Pomegranates. Village of Maestrazgo. Pedraza Market. Northern Architecture. In 1958, the Grand National Primo de Rivera Prize was won by the Cuban artist Pancho Cosillo. By this artist, one of the most sound of the 20th century, a synthesis between lyrical post-cubism from the school of Paris and the great classical naturalist tradition, we can relish his work, The Vase. This splendid canvas transforms shapes into an illusion of flatness. In this same year, Juan Lloret Torregrosa won the first prize in the provincial competition. A self-taught and alert man, though perhaps somewhat timid, he became an exceptional artistic personality. The 1959 canvas, Tranquility in the Port, is a revelation of the force that impregnates his painting with characteristically dark tones. The decade of the 50s brought a great cultural and artistic effervescence. Various Alicante artists took part in the Biennial Exhibition of Vienna of 1954. Outstanding amongst them was Juana Frances. Two of her works are exhibited by MUBAG: Red Box and Black Box. In 1957, the first exhibition of Mediterranean sculpture took place. The top prize fell to the Valencian sculptor Salvador Octavio Vicente Cortina. His art exudes an aesthetic zeal that is an invitation to search for formal beauty. Two of his pieces can be found in the museum: Nude Standing and By the Sea. In the next exhibition of Mediterranean sculpture, the first prize fell to Benjamin Mustielis Navarro, a classic artist in tune with the aesthetic wind that blew at the end of the Civil War. The Bather, the winning work and a beautifully crafted piece, is housed by MUBAG. It was in 1962 that Pauline Laporta, serene painter, intimate and nostalgic, won the silver medal in the first competition of plastic art of Alicante. We can enjoy three of her works: The Antique Shop, The Lover, in which we discover a world of evocation and nostalgia. And one of her most important pieces, The Five Generations of Maria. This canvas, so realistic that it makes us think of Antonio Lopez, is an exquisite expression of silence and also of life. Another excellent group of works, such as Female Head by the Alcoyan painter Adolfo Dura, Costa Brava and Family Scene by Vicente Albarranch Blasco, Monovar by Luis Vidal Maestre, Orchetta by Enrique Lledó, Still Life by José Marcet, Landscape by José Galvez Rog, Cove and Cape of St. Martin by Juan Bautista Segarra, or Mooring Boats by Fernando Soria, make up a brilliant journey through the painting and the sculpture of the 20th century, exhibited by MUBAG of Alicante.